universe is like taking a trip down memory lane. The farther from Earth we look, the farther back in time we see. The farther back in time we see.
And welcome to the most must-see show on Bedford TV today. I am your host with the most, Ken Hill, with the episode 35 of The Wrestling Connection, where it is okay to wear white after Labor Day, and yes, I am that man you saw on TV. Normally I'm surrounded with my good friends and co-hosts, the lovely Ashley and the madman himself, Zach Martinkus. However, Ashley is out with some back trouble, and Zach, the ever faithful, doting husband-to-be, is at her side. So I wish Ashley nothing but the best and a speedy recovery, and I hope you guys come back soon. Anyway, so I'm solo for this week, but just like Shawn Michaels once promised as part of D-Generation X, and I like to paraphrase, you may only have half of the dynamic duo, but I promise to bring twice the fun. So we jump into this week in review. We have Hell in a Cell coming up rather quickly, and thankfully, with this past Monday night, the card for Hell in a Cell got a bit more fleshed out. We had more matches made, particularly pertaining to Ambrose and Cena. Ambrose came out at the top of the show this week, intent on confronting not only Rollins, but taking on the entire authority, and Cena saw fit to come out and confront Ambrose about this, saying, "Okay, so you want to take on the authority? You want to take on the entire authority? Good luck with that. It's going that insane route's gonna get you a short career," is what Cena essentially told Ambrose. He was trying to give him veteran advice, only for Ambrose to turn Big Brother Cena down and get in his face. Cena only warned Ambrose that you need to focus because you got the biggest match of your life in 2 weeks. And it seemed like the two were ready to come to blows, except here comes Triple H and Stephanie, who actually were having an argument of their own. Triple H believed that Ambrose and Cena were going to come to blows. Stephanie believed that Cena and Ambrose were reluctant to come to blows with each other. So they decided to put that to the test. They have a standard bet between Stephanie and Triple H to put Cena and Ambrose in a tag team situation, a triple threat tag team match with the Usos and the tag team champions Star and Goldust. Now, for the most part, Cena and Ambrose functioned relatively well as a tag team, as you can see here with the Usos and Golden Stardust. They fared relatively well, and even actually managed to pick up the win over the tag team champions, with Cena pitting Goldust as Ambrose laid out Stardust with the Dirty Deeds DDT. However, and after Stephanie won the bet, the standard authority bet, one whole dollar. that's a standard bet. I figured it would be $9.99. Triple H was upset, but he could still sense the seething animosity between Cena and Ambrose, because they still had their contract on a poll match to see who would face Rollins in Hell in a Cell in 2 weeks. And he said, why wait? Why wait until Hell in a Cell and let's have the match? Let's have the contract on a poll match for the main event. No holds barred. Dean Ambrose, John Cena. And he claimed it was going to be hell for both men because the authority would be down there personally to oversee things. And we all know how well things go when the authority sticks their nose in someone's business. Well, that's still a little ways off. Speaking of the authority, Randy Orton, who had actually been voicing some frustration over not being on the card for Hell in a Cell, took out his frustrations on one Intercontinental Champion, Dolph Ziggler. Now, of course, this was a hotly contested match, several near falls, a very athletic contest. Ziggler nearly coming out on top a number of times, almost pulling up the win, only for Orton to come away after countering the Famouser into an RKO, a midair RKO, a very good move by Mr. Orton. And he made his frustrations known to the Authority following the match, saying, okay, I know the winner gets to face...
On his front camera?
The winner gets to face Rollins. I want to face whoever doesn't get to face Rollins. So Orton wanted the quote-unquote loser of the match, something I'll actually talk about a little later on in the dirt sheet segment. So there's that. And speaking of Rollins, Rollins and Orton seem to be having a lot of tension as of late, being that Rollins is being more focused as part of the leading man of the authority, where Orton has been sort of shunted into the background. And there's been a lot of tension between the two. Rollins had his own concerns to worry about, though, his own match to worry about, though, going up against the ultra-athletic, the ultra-competitive, real American Jack Swagger. Now, for a short contest, this was a fun little match here. Swagger countering several of Rollins' signature maneuvers, including at one point countering the curb stomp into the Patriot Lock, the ankle lock. It was a fantastic little athletic contest between the two, only for Rollins to roll up Swagger out of nowhere for the surprise three count. Now moving on, we come to what has been a little interesting feud. I mean, you have for the United States champion Sheamus going up against the Mr. Moneymaker himself, The Miz. Now, Miz did pick up a surprise victory over the United States champion last week, thanks to the help of his stunt double, Damian Mizdow. And Mizdow, once again, has been paying more and more dividends for The Miz in recent weeks, including this past Monday Night on Raw, where once again The Miz and Sheamus faced off in a non-title match. At one point, Sandow interfered, and both he and Miz would escape under the ring, only for Sheamus to come after them in hot pursuit. Sheamus would manage to pull out Mizdow, lay him out with a bro kick, only for Miz to roll back in the ring from the other side and pick up a count-out victory over the United States champion. So 2 weeks, two straight victories for Mr. Moneymaker himself, The Miz, and it's what responsible for Miz getting a United States Championship match at Hell in a Cell. Will Mizdow play a factor in that? Remains to be seen, and something we'll be highlighting as part of our Hell in a Cell paper preview next Friday. Now, we come to what was one of the more heavily advertised matches from this past Monday night on Raw. That being Big Show versus Rusev. Now, Big Show last week had to enter sensitivity training since he pulled down the Russian flag in the middle of the ring, which is more or less a big no-no any way you cut it. So, Rusev and Big Show faced off this week on Raw. It was a hard-hitting contest. Rusev, surprisingly athletic, dropping, disorienting Big Show with drop kicks and strikes and surprising a lot of people, like taking it to the Big Show, something you don't see a lot of people do. And you can actually see here Rusev closing in on the victory, locking Big Show in the accolade, something I didn't think he could do, which surprised me, and something you could obviously see surprised Mark Henry, Big Show's good friend who showed up at ringside. However, Henry saw fit to come in, break up the accolade, causing a disqualification, giving Rusev yet another victory and remaining undefeated. However, Rusev would not get away scot-free as he tried to celebrate a little too much, unfurling the Russian flag in the middle of the ring once again. Rusev, Henry and Sho would go out to confront him, and when he tried to take it to Henry, he turned around right into another Big Sho KO punch. And according to WWE.com, a rematch has been issued to Rusev. He and Lana have accepted. It will be Big Sho versus Rusev at Hell in a Cell. And just like with Mizdow getting involved in the Miz-Sheamus match, we'll have to see if Big Show's good best friend, Mark Henry, will play a factor in the upcoming rematch between Rusev and Big Sho. Now, in the ever-continuing saga, that is AJ and Paige over the Divas Championship, we had a tag team match of sorts with AJ and Layla going up against the quirky duo of Alicia Fox and Paige. Now, last week, AJ showed that she doesn't always play nice. She kind of left her bubbly dancing tag team partner, Emma, to the wolves, kind of saying, forget it, I want a serious tag team partner. I don't like having these bubbly bleach blonde divas as my tag team partners, and left Emma high and dry. Now, funny thing is, they had a pre-taped segment with AJ talking to Layla, say, I promise I won't abandon you. You're the diva I least hate. She actually said that. Layla, you are the diva I least hate, so you have no worries. And they had the most awkward hug you will ever see on television. safe to say, they did not get along in the tag team match. At one point, Layla pulling the switch on AJ, abandoning AJ to Alicia and Paige, only for AJ to pick up the surprise win, hitting Alicia Fox with a Shining Wizard for the three ball, the three count and the victory. Now, I mean, again, so you have this back and forth feud between Paige and AJ, and with Alicia thrown in there, and it begs the question, who's going to come out on top here? Who's really going to be the one to? I mean, no one knows. So it'll be interesting to see if Alicia gets thrown into the mix here for this Divas title match, or if it'll just be another one-on-one rematch in the, like I said, in the ever-continuing saga that is AJ and Paige. Now, we come to the main event. The no-holds-barred contract on a pole match between Cena and Ambrose. Now, this was a contrast of styles, because you had the wild, crazy, erratic style of Ambrose. You had the hard-hitting, straight-in-your-face offense of Cena, and it made for an interesting clash. I mean, they fought over ringside, in the ring, out the ring, into the stands. I mean, at one point, Cena throwing Ambrose into the Authority. And here comes a little bit of genius on Ambrose's part. He socked Orton, and then Cena threw Ambrose into the Authority, almost guaranteeing that the Authority was going to get involved here. And as Cena is valiantly fighting off the Authority, fighting off Orton, fighting off Kane, suddenly, oh, here goes Ambrose climbing up, going through the back door, standing on the top rope, and with a little "you can't see me" taunt to John Cena, pulls down a contract, guaranteeing that Ambrose will be the one to see Cena to face Ambrose will be facing Rollins at Hell in a Cell, and Cena, for what seems to be the millionth time, facing Randy Orton in a Hell in a Cell match. Safe to say, a very eventful Raw is. Like I said, the card for Night of Champions, for Hell in a Cell has become a little more fleshed out. We have a United States Championship match, we have a pair of Hell in a Cell matches, and sad to say, we also have a Divas match. Not a Divas title match, but a Divas match with Brie and Nikki Bella facing off with Nikki Bella, who, the winner, the loser of that match, being the winner's personal assistant for a month. Riveting television, I know. Now, anyway, we come into this week's superstar profile, where I said last week, we're kind of doing a two-part exploration bit here. We explored Rowan and Harper last week, kind of like what their future is as single competitors and as a tag team. This week, we explore the future, the present and future of the head of the Wyatt family, or should I say former head of the Wyatt family, Bray Wyatt. So, as I've mentioned in the news the last couple weeks, the plan is for Bray Wyatt and Luke and Harper and Rowan to be split up. I mean, we've seen vignettes, we've seen videos in the last couple weeks explaining that Bray is releasing Rowan and Harper into the world. He's letting them go on their own. Letting them forge their own path, if you will. So again, I explored where that could lead for Rowan and Harper, whether they should be kept as a tag team or they should pursue singles careers. And I mentioned that Harper had the greater potential for a singles career. But again, it begs the question, where does that leave Bray Wyatt? Because as we've explored in past months, Bray has always had more success when he hasn't had the Wyatt family with him. Like, he was successful in his feud with Chris Jericho. He won the cage match. He won the match at SummerSlam. I mean, he beat Daniel Bryan earlier in the year at the Royal Rumble when it was just a one-on-one match, no Wyatt family. So the best success we have seen for Bray Wyatt is when he's been on his own. So I think this could actually be a prime opportunity for him to kind of like explore the individual character Bray Wyatt, not just as the head of the Wyatt family, but more explore the individual himself. I think it's a great chance for WWE to repackage Wyatt a bit, kind of like go in a new direction. Because I mean, we've kind of been seeing we've seen images of this pregnant lady, saying it, and Bray Wyatt saying, "It's coming." Who's coming? It could be the sister Abigail we've heard so much about in Bray Wyatt's promos. It could be the debut of a diva. It could be something else entirely. We don't know. Bray Wyatt's always been very mysterious, cryptic, charismatic, very just an oddball in general. So I think the next few weeks will be very interesting in terms of the direction of Bray Wyatt's character, seeing where they go from here. I mean, do they just keep pushing him, or they take Bray Wyatt in another direction as a hopes of finally rejuvenating his character and bringing interest back to Bray Wyatt? Another option, something I talked about last week, there is a tag team down in NXT called The Ascension, made up of Connor and Victor. The tag team named The Ascension with members Connor and Victor. They are a brooding, brutal tag team. They dress dark. I mean, they have a brutal, straightforward, sock 'em in the mouth wrestling style. Like, I mean, these two, The Ascension, were the longest reigning champions in NXT history in nearly a year. In nearly 320 plus days as NXT's tag team champions. And the competition, they would wrestle anyone. They would wrestle local competition. They would wrestle contracted wrestlers from WWE, from Raw and SmackDown. These two would dominate the tag team division for months. And it was not until recently that they were finally upended for the NXT tag team titles by Kalisto and Sin Cara, the upcoming tag team, the Lucha Dragons. So again, now that they're no longer NXT tag team champions, they lost their rematch, they're kind of just sort of drifting through NXT, there's not a whole lot left for the Ascension, except maybe being brought up to the WWE to help bolster the tag team ranks. And not just that. One of the rumors going around the dirt sheets is that the Ascension could be brought up as new lackeys, as new cohorts for Bray Wyatt and the Wyatt family. Sort of a revamp of the Wyatt family, if you will. Kind of like they did with the Brood. Now you had Gangrel, Edge, and Christian. And then you had the new Brood with Gangrel, Matt, and Jeff Hardy. This is sort of the same thing right here. Now, instead of just having the Wyatt family, Bray Wyatt, Roan, and Harper, now you could have Bray Wyatt and the Ascension.
Believe the hype.
I think it could be a good direction for the Ascension. I think it could be a good way to introduce them to the mainstream WWE audience. We'll see. Everything's still
Recognize.
In the planning stages, so we'll see
Recognize.
where this whole Vignette storyline turns out for Bray Wyatt and the Ascension. We now go into Pro Wrestling 101. A couple of things here. I've been asked this before, and people have asked me, what is a dark match? A dark match is when you go to a live event, you go to a Raw or a SmackDown show, and they have, like, right before they do the intro, before they do the pyros and all that, they play the entrance, they have, like, a match that will feature, like, either local talent or, like, upcoming talent, like, developmental talent, like, from NXT. And, like, it'll be, like, sort of a proving ground for them, kind of like a little bonus for the live audience to get to see these new guys in action before the live show starts. So that's where a dark match is. You could also have like a post-show dark match where like they throw out the storylines. They have a big time face off against a big time heel, or they have like a big 3-man, 6-man, or 8-man tag team match. Just no storylines, just fighting out to see who comes out on top. It's like a dark match is like a bonus match for the live audience. That's what it is. It's a dark match. It's untelevised. Now, something that our producer here at Bedford TV, Brian asked me is like heels, faces, and tweeners. Like, what's the difference?
I apologize.
I mean, heels in wrestling are guys you love to hate. You just absolutely, you can't stand, but they're entertaining enough for you that you want to watch them. That these are guys and these are guys and girls that you want to see get beat up. You want to see them get their comeuppance for all the mean, despicable things that they say and do. That's what heels are. I mean, faces are obviously, they're baby faces. They're the heroic good guys. They're the ones that people love to get behind. They're the high flyers. They're the people, or the big heroic baby faces like Hulk Hogan and John Cena. Those are what faces are. Then you have the tweeners. You kind of have like the guys that are like, they're not faces, they're not heels. They're kind of like anti-heroes. Like, they do villainous things, but people love them for it. Like the ultimate anti-hero, the ultimate tweener, was Stone Cold Steve Austin. Stone Cold Steve Austin was the ultimate tweener. I mean, he did villainous things. He held the owner of WWE, Vince McMahon, at gunpoint, only to fake him out with a prop gun. He demolished D-Generation X's tour bus. He He drove a Zamboni into arena one time just to dive over a bunch of National Guard security to get to Vince McMahon. I mean, that's what a tweener was. A tweener was a guy who wasn't a full-on hero, but he also wasn't a full-on villain. That's what a tweener is.
Recognize.
Next, we come to cleaning up the dirt sheets. A couple of articles I saw this past week. One I thought was spot on was that supposedly they constructed the main event as a way to save face for Orton and Cena, so that even though Cena technically lost the contract on a pole match, he wasn't the loser of the match because he would face Orton at Hell in a Cell. They structured it so it didn't seem like that Cena was getting a runner-up thing. That it was, it's not like Cena lost. He still gets to face Orton at Hell in a Cell. That's what the whole point of the article was that it was saving, that WWE wanted to save face for Orton and Cena. Why would you want to save face for Orton and Cena? They've been your two big time main eventers for the last, 8 years. They don't need saving. They don't need to have any face saving whatsoever. People aren't going to forget about them just because they're not in the in the absolute top end of the show main event for a pay-per-view like Hell in a Cell. People aren't going to forget them. All right. And the other thing is that just makes me laugh is that supposedly there's an article out here that says that supposedly TNA is 10 days away from Total Nonstop Action, Impact Wrestling, WWE's rival, is 10 days away from signing a new low-tier, way less money TV contract deal with WGN America, based out of Chicago, CM Punk's hometown, and 10 days away just happens to be CM Punk's birthday. So cue the entire internet wrestling community, IWC, exploding, saying, oh my God, they're going to sign Punk to Impact Wrestling. It doesn't mean diddly squat. It doesn't mean anything like that. I mean, okay, Punk has made it loud and clear. He doesn't like TNA. The fact is, TNA passed him up in 2004 and 2005. Punk, WWE scooped him right up, and then he had the whole Summer of Punk in 2011, and TNA is kicking themselves over this. I discussed it last week. TNA signing Punk would be a huge deal. It would bring legitimacy to TNA. It would bring a huge, big-name superstar to TNA and bring a whole lot of viewing fans to see Punk in TNA. I have no doubt that Punk being signed to TNA would be the modern-day equivalent of Hulk Hogan being signed to WCW. I have no doubt about that. But the likelihood of it happening, slim to none. Punk has went on record saying he doesn't like TNA. He doesn't like the direction. He doesn't like the people running it. He just doesn't like it, period. So TNA is going to have to offer up a pretty sweet deal to Mr. Punker if they want to have him in their company. And that's a big if. And actually, we're coming to the end of our show, ladies and gentlemen. We didn't really have time for Ken's Den this week because of what happened. However, we do have a new intro video for Stall. Okay. We're having some technical difficulties, ladies and gentlemen.
2 minutes will be good.
2 minutes? Okay.
Can you just explain a little bit of what Hell in a Cell is?
Okay. All right. So, for Brian's sake, I'll give a little explanation about Hell in a Cell. Hell in a Cell is a concept introduced in the late 90s in World Wrestling by the World Wrestling Federation. Essentially, it's like a steel cage match, except it's 25 feet high and has a roof over the top. Essentially, Hell in a Cell was the steel cage match taken to an entire new level. Essentially, there's no escape from Hell in a Cell. No way to get out. two men locked inside what was called the Devil's Playground, the Devil's Plaything. Essentially, it was it could be considered the be-all, end-all to a feud. If you want a match, if you wanted to have a big blow-off, a big payoff for a big-time feud, Hell in a Cell was the way to do it. I mean, you had the very first Hell in a Cell match, Shawn Michaels versus The Undertaker. You had Undertaker versus Mankind from 1998, King of the Ring. You had Triple H versus Shawn Michaels. You had Triple H versus Cactus Jack versus Mick Foley. You had Triple H versus Batista. You had Undertaker versus Batista. Undertaker versus Edge. You've had so many marquee Hell in a Cell matches that have been so brutal, so violent, so bloody that you could not believe what you were seeing. And like I said, one of the more surreal moments in Hell in a Cell happened when you can see it every time intro plays for the show is Mankind, Mick Foley, getting tossed 25 feet off the top of the Hell in a Cell through an announce table. It shortened not only Mick Foley's career, but his life. And to this day, Foley still talks about the pains and twitches he feels from taking that big dive through the announce table. It just goes to show that Hell in a Cell is a dangerous match that, I mean, again, it's the be-all, end-all for a feud. It could also be the be-all, end-all for a career. It could take weeks, months, even years off a man's career going into Hell in a Cell. Because it's, like I said, it's brutal, it's violent, it's bloody. And it's why you don't see them as often as maybe some hardcore wrestling fans would like. So, I mean, again, and my problem with the Hell in a Cell pay-per-view is that it waters down the concept of Hell in a Cell. I mean, it's supposed to be this big-time gimmick match that you reserve for the absolute end of a feud when you want to have, like I said before, you want to have the biggest payoff, the biggest blow-off to a feud possible. You want to have Hell in a Cell, but with a Hell in a Cell pay-per-view, like they've had, which was introduced in 2009, it just doesn't have the same impact that it used to. I mean, you had some decent matches, but I'm hoping that with 2014, with Ambrose and Rollins facing off, that maybe we can revisit the intensity and brutality that we saw in Hell in a Cells in the past decade. Well, and now, ladies and gentlemen, right before we sign off, I'd like to introduce for you the new, the brand new, spanking new, fresh, hot off the presses video for Ken's Den. Check it out. I'm going to be the voice of professional wrestling. You need to be smart enough. You need to toughen up. If you want to be the future of WWE, you got to go through me.
You got to go through me.
I apologize.
Again, that's the end of our show, ladies and gentlemen. Like I said, if you have any comments about the show, be sure to contact us on our Facebook page, facebook.com/thewrestlingconnection. If you have like any inquiries or any questions, ideas for the show, if you would actually like to be a guest on the show, if you have any wrestling related stories you'd like to talk about, if you'd like to be a guest, you can reach us at wrestlingconnection@gmail.com. That's wrestlingconnection@gmail.com. Gmail.com. You can also... Just connection. So that way they know how to spell it. So you can also reach us at WConnection on Twitter. Like I said, you have our Facebook page, email, wrestlingconnection@gmail.com. Like I said, any comments or ideas you want to offer for the show, anything you want to discuss with me or Zach, don't be afraid to hit us up. Next week is going to be our paper preview for Hell in a Cell 2014. So be sure to catch that. Hopefully we'll have more matches by next Friday. Well, that's the end of the show. For my erstwhile co-hosts Zach and Ashley, again, I wish you guys nothing but the best. I am Ken Hill. This is the Wrestling Connection. And remember that we are connecting our world to yours. Be connected, get connected, stay connected.
Recognize.